Hi, welcome to day four of our course on Keep Haring Graffiti. Today begins a series that I will show you in a more detailed way what Haring did during his brief period of life. Okay, but this first series goes from 1980 to 1984. Okay, I will start in 1980, showing some images, and then you will watch a video when he spent 3 weeks in Australia in 1984. Okay. In 1980, as you already know, he started making drawings with white chalk at New York subway stations. He started to gain notoriety, and his first exhibitions took place in alternative spaces and clubs in the city. In 1981, Keith Haring held his first individual exhibition in New York at Westbeth Painter's Space. And here you can see the original posters for his exhibition. Another view of the building Westbeth Painter's Space. In a short time, he was already participating in exhibitions and performances at the avant-garde Club 57. These are the original posters for Haring's shows at Club 57. And the flyers advertising events at Club 57, like this one, designed by Keith Haring, were often works of art themselves. Now you can see the building nowadays. In 1982, he made his big debut at the Tony Schiaffrazzi Gallery in Soho. He began to become one of the most celebrated artists of the decade. And in the same year, during the summer, in New York, Keith Haring painted his first large-scale public work on the famous Houston Bowery Wall, previously a graffiti hall of fame. And many street artists have since created murals on the same wall, turning it into an iconic street art spot in New York. And of course, this outdoor mural no longer exists. His international recognition came with the exhibition at Documenta 7 in Kassel, Germany in 1982. In 1983, Keith Haring was invited to participate at the Whitney Museum Biennial in New York. After that, in the same year, he participated in a São Paulo Biennial. And here you can see Keith painting the mural. And here it is, the mural done. And then in Naples, in Lucio Amelio Gallery, this is the man, the owner of the gallery. And this is the poster for the exhibition in Milan in 1984. On these international trips, Keith Haring got in touch with other cultures and noticed the universality in his artistic language when he saw African and also in Australia the Aboriginal works.
In 1984, Keith Haring was invited to create some murals in Australia, and now you can watch the video. Enjoy!
They can turn the water off. They can turn the water off. You know, if you wanted to work on this side, you could. See, it's just a thin film of water running down there the whole time. But on the other side, you see, what would be interesting to see what happens with the water running down. I mean, to see what that does to the to help make it very fuzzy.
I didn't know when I was first speaking to Keith exactly what he would be doing, but I knew that there were going to be lots of possibilities, and I knew that they were going to be fairly limitless simply because of the nature of his work. I already have in mind when I approach somebody, I think to some extent, what that person might be able to do, because I know the sort of circuit that that artist can be fitted into. I think that's one of the things about doing visiting artists' projects. You do instinctively seize on something that you know is going to be exciting and interesting and workable in a practical sort of way. I was in London, and there was a show there very much about a group of New York artists involved in urban imagery and urban concerns. Now, it was the scale, the energy, the excitement that immediately drew me. That whole graffiti guerrilla strategy which goes with the thing, moving into something, striking quickly, you know, the work is there, bang, very, very suddenly. And that's part of the excitement and part of the energy of the work too.
Kind of story about life in the modern world and maybe about the future.
Are you gonna paint it more better?
What?
Are you gonna paint it more better? Might put a couple of colors inside.
Yeah, there's more colors.
So you just painted it white.
Do you know Michael
Jackson?
Next
time you see him, say Nicole
really.
And Heidi said
hello. Walk on water, walk on sand.
Art's blatant sort of copy of Aboriginal styles and Australian folklore in general. I don't think it's on for a New York artist to come to Australia and give Australians a meat pie, as it were. And but as for actually painting, it's on the
American
gallery.
Isn't he? Yeah, right. Used to do graffiti work on stations. Yeah.
Well, do you like his work?
Yeah, it's great. It's
Do you get something from it?
I hope they don't rub it off.
They
that's
will.
For sure. They will. How pathetic. Last time Daniel Buren did a piece on the Ark just here and they took it off. It's just pathetic. Why don't they just stop that sort of let's keep our building precious, keep the works they got here now?
Yeah, well, I know they're going to take it off in about a month's time.
I paint with lines, so I make lines. And whether I'm making a line with a piece of chalk or a stick or a paintbrush, the end result is a crisp, solid line that's depicting and cutting through space. The way that I'm using images and drawing goes right back to the much more original idea or the more basic idea of what drawing really is. Man making an image in the world or making some connection between man and the world that he lives in. That's the reason why it has so much in common with art of other cultures. I mean, when I come here and I see all these Aboriginal drawings and it looks like things I've been drawing. The sort of level of concentration that's going on while you're drawing is somewhere in between ritual and work, because in some ways you're in a heightened state of awareness because the amount of attention you have to pay to every move that you're making and sort of the complete synchronicity of your body and your eyes, the way your hand is moving so that you're exactly holding the brush at the right angle away from the thing. But if you lose it, you start to do things like when you bring a circle around and bring the other side up, it doesn't match up, so you've got a little bump. I mean, there's a lot of times where that'll happen in a drawing. Even though you're not painting to the rhythm necessarily or painting to the beat of the music, is still keeping a sort of steady level of concentration, or maybe it's a level of unconcentration so that you have enough room to not think about what you're doing so that it just happens automatically.
Minister, Patrick, members of the press and media, I see that this marvellous piece that Keith Haring has done as being, in a sense, symbolic. The image of birth in the centre panel is not entirely inappropriate to the occasion, and it has the energy and the excitement and the enthusiasm that I hope will colour all of the activities of the Centre for Contemporary Art in the future.
Mr. Haring can be interrupted momentarily from his work, but you do understand he's still got a long way to go. I hope we won't distract him too much from his creative labours.
But also in a sort of, in a ritual sort of way, so that it's also a celebration in some ways.
Have you studied Aboriginal art?
But the specific images sort of have changed a little bit from
it
being here,
slightly
adapted to that place, so that it is sort of particularly other things will be inside. The center part is going to be much more dense.
It really depends on the individual policeman, because a lot of the cops like the drawings. So sometimes when they cast me, they've been waiting
dealing with the modern world or the dilemma of man now being in a position where he controls his own destiny.
Spread my arms out. It's a tacky pose, but ta-da.
I guess, yeah. Sometimes.
And it's just going to show one other thing.
Hard to deal with, but I'm used to it.
You have to not only be a good painter, but you also have to be able to deal with being photographed,
and all of a sudden you become a model and a performer and all these other things, which...
That's what you enjoy, isn't it?
Well, it has nothing... I don't know. Sometimes I enjoy it, sometimes I don't, but it doesn't matter whether you enjoy it or not. You still have to do it. You know, it becomes...
How do you practice something...
I mean, I've gotten much more at ease at it than I was in the beginning, you know.
All it does is it sort of blocks out the inside, which is good. You know, it makes the things on the inside blurry, but the lines, you can still see the lines really good.
So you reckon you'll keep the water on?
Yeah, I think they should keep it on. Because that's the whole idea of the wall is that it's a water wall, right? So,
but did you have that?
I mean, I knew there was going to be water running down it when I painted it, so I didn't paint things about water on it, but I don't think it doesn't hurt it at all. Yeah, well, that's, I guess... I mean, I thought of putting the whole, you know, making the whole thing be about water, but... No, I think the water's good on it. Yeah, let the water on. Are those your film lights, or are those the normal lights for the inside?
No, I think they're the lights of the gallery.
Because the light in that atomic bomb looks great. With water coming through it.
Do you think that it's what you expected, or did you have any sort of preconceived idea about it?
Well, a little, you know, I mean, thought about it a little bit, but it's pretty much innovative as you go, really.
Do you like what you've done? Sort of,
yeah, I guess. Why, do you?
I like it.
I mean, I never know. When people ask you, like, how do you think it's going? Or, you know, do you think it turned out well? And I never know.
But don't you know what's good with your own work, or can you only criticize others?
Well, I always like it. I guess if I, you know. I mean, you have to always like it, sort of.
I've got a feeling you like your work quite a lot, actually.
No, I mean, if I had done something I didn't like, I would have scraped it off or something. But I don't, you know.
You've never done that?
No.
But how bad? Well, this is just... That one's all right. Maybe the worst ones are inside. Are the worst ones inside?
This one's not bad.
Look, I'll show you. I'll open at the damage. There's a block there.
That's not, that can be touched up.
On that one?
But it's smudged there too. That's not that. I can touch that.
There's one in here.
I make it look on purpose.
Don't be so. I was just kidding.
Which one, that one?
It has a little smudge there.
That can be cleaned up on the eraser.
But this one here is the worst.
So is that. That's ruined.
That one's ruined.
Can't it be touched up?
No.
I mean,
if I had got in there in time, it could have been worse. I think this one's a write-off, and that one is not good. What about this one?
That one's okay.
I don't mind those little
aberrations there. That was from
it was? Yeah. Oh, I thought he'd done that as well.
No, that was from me. I'm dripping it while the orange was still wet. That one's all right. I don't want to throw that away, though. I really like it.
go today?
It was great.
I mean, we got more than I expected done. It was almost halfway done, so it will probably be finished tomorrow. I'll save some for Thursday, because there's supposed to be press Thursday morning. So I just saved a little piece around the back corner.
Literally got to hold it off for the press.
Well, it won't be any problem. I mean, I'll just, you know, there's about a good day's work there tomorrow. So.
There's no drips on your...
Yeah, I was sort of surprised, actually. I mean, this is one of the first ones I ever did with no drips at all.
Deliberate?
It doesn't usually happen. Well, I never try to make drips. I mean, drips happen because of the kind of paint. You know, the plastic, this consistency of the paint makes decides whether they're drips or not. But,
Actually,
I was going to mention earlier, but I thought I should not say anything about it until I don't have, because now that I said there's no drips, I know tomorrow there are going to be drips. So I wish they would still let me do this thing on the outside, but I don't think they're going to.
What's that? Put a...
I want to do put a panel inside, because they only have four of them, and they have slots for like, the rest. I guess they ran out of money or something. So I want to make a plywood one and stick it in there. I mean, it would be perfect. But I don't think they're ready to go for it. But maybe when this painting's done, they'll be convinced. She's watching this on film, but she's really shady. I don't really know. It's like she's real nice, and then she says really mean things, and then she's really nice again, so I don't understand what her deal is. But I can't keep saying.
Well, I mean, she said she was...
Because now she was already, and now she says it's going to be up for 3 months. First, she says it's going to be up for, you know, I'm just finishing this big painting, right? Incredible painting. And she comes to tell, you know, say it's going to be repainted in 1 month. And I was like, a month is so quick. Because that means it wouldn't even be up in time for the Biennale. And the one great thing about it happening now, even if it's up for 3 months, is if it's up during the Biennale, then a lot of people are going to come from other countries and things, and we'll see it, right? And it'll be part of, you know, they'll see that at the same time.
Did the director see the work?
I don't know. I guess it comes down, he didn't say anything to me. I see him, like, looking from the side, but he didn't say anything or smile or anything. So, yeah. I guess I was, like, expecting too much because I was coming from Melbourne and the incredible way I was treated there. I just, you know.
It's not like Melbourne.
No. But it doesn't matter because it's not for the museum, it's for the people. And the people are the same anywhere. So people coming, I mean, you can't, like, get mad and take it out on the museum because it's not for the directors anyway. I mean, even though once I'm gone, later on, they'll take credit for it and say that, you know, they had the insight to get Keith Haring here and all these things. Like, when they finally realize that that'll do them some good, then they'll do that. I mean, still, it's better for me to cut out the commercial galleries and go directly to the museum. You know, because it's going right from the street to the museum and cutting out commercial galleries completely. That's the best way to go, right? Because it's in the middle part with commercial galleries that it starts to get confused and sticky. But here it's already from the street to a public institution, which is, you know, a perfect crossover. Favorite city I've been in Australia, or favorite city in the world?
Around the world, what do you like?
I guess Tokyo's, well, New York's my favorite city, and then probably Tokyo. The city was all right, but just as far as cities go, but I guess it wouldn't really be up there with my...
Sorry?
I guess it wouldn't be up there with my top favorite cities, but it was okay. In most places, have something about them that are unique and make it interesting.
What about Tokyo? What is it about Tokyo?
Well, I think because
it's the most space-age city that exists. And it's sort of the most interesting clash between culture and tradition and old things and new.
He's just upstairs painting babies on his stomach, photographers.
Is he?
And he'll be down in a second.
Good.
What we're going to do, let me explain. I didn't tell you that we're going to have a film crew. The film crew is sort of like just here all the time. Mm. And I mean, they're making a film about Keith in Australia. He'll be down in a minute and then we can just start the meeting.
Okay.
So it shouldn't take too long. Because somebody coming to interview him again at 1 o'clock, it's just been back to back, sort of like all morning.
Pussy, I didn't know you weren't modelling anyway. I would have done something for you. I thought you were modelling for Bruce and Sarah.
Yeah,
they asked me to put time, so.
I said no.
You've met Robert? Yep.
And Pussy?
Robert and have you met before? Pussy. And Robert Pierce.
Well, the parade consists of about 30 artists, fashion designers, it's an industrial designer and an engineer. And they're all creating different costumes, so to speak, for a big parade that will take place on a big stage that has about four separate little stages.
Did you talk specifically about what Keith might do?
No, not really. Well,
not really. We didn't want to impose anything on him, you know.
I think the idea of painting a body is the most interesting to me.
How many would you paint?
I think just one.
Just one?
Yeah.
Or two at the most.
Because
I'd rather do one and do it really well than do a couple half-assed.
Sure.
Oh, red or blue?
Blue, I reckon. What do you mean?
I don't know.
Blue because red's all around.
Might be natural color.
Oh, no, you've got to paint it. No, I don't want people to see my real nipples. I'm an exhibitionist, man.
Who knows? And this one's better to dance to than that.
This is a P job original.
Don't do it on purpose.
Oh no! It's going out of quick.
When you applied for this job, you didn't say you had any twitches.
Yes, I did. I said I got cold very easily.
You turn off. Can someone turn the heater back on?
But put on. No. That'll just burn.
No, but on number like one or two instead of on off.
So how long have you been an artist, man?
Now's a good time to ask me that. About 15 minutes, I just... It's my first time I ever did this.
They just grabbed me off the street. What the hell is this?
A snake.
Is it a nice snake? What's its name?
I was at a disco, and I walked down the stairway past a man about town. So I like flashed me, you know. I walked down kind of seductively. Anyway, I grabbed his attention, and with him was a gentleman, an artist, who claimed that he was looking for someone to do this modeling job. It's great. He's very lighthearted, he just likes to fuck around, muck around a lot. You know, we went to the paint store. He was very jumpy and speedy and laughing a lot, passing out his badges to all the people in the shop. He's very nice, very intelligent. About the parade?
Tonight, performance.
Yeah, I'm shitting myself.
Should I?
out of 10 for your own effort in the town. No, come on.
Considering the amount of time we did it, 10 or 9.
Can you recognize it?
Up next, Rap Dancing by Isolation, Radio by Kenny Sharp, Body Jockstraps, Hats, and T-shirts by Keith Haring.
Like the painting was a backup for that, really.
I don't think so.
And it was good they didn't read that whole spiel that they had written down on paper to read before. It's much better.
Hey, how are you? How do you feel?
Fine. I'm enjoying it now. I like all this filming of you all the time. I just learned to like ignore it.
Now, what are your plans for this evening? Are you
getting the stuff and going, getting clean, and then. What was the name of that place to say we were going to go to?
Me?
Yeah,
thank
see
you.
That.
See Sandy in the sunset.
Yeah, I might do that. I don't know.
So we might see you or we might not.
Right.
Well, we'll bring you.
It's much easier to sit down and talk about drawing when I'm not drawing. I mean, I can't talk about what I just did because I don't know what I just did, you know. I can talk about drawing when, I mean, I thought we were going to sit down and we'll tape all those things when I just talk, right? Yeah. I don't like to talk about what I'm doing when I'm doing it because I don't know what I'm doing when I do it.
Right. I just
that's
wanted to get...
I mean, I said you could come in if you want, film me while I'm drawing. But I don't want to, I mean, I'll sit down and talk, say all kinds of things when I'm there to talk, but...
But as you
the
do,
two don't go hand in
you
hand.
You can't tell me if you feel happy about what you're doing at the moment.
Because that's not what it's about, you know. I mean, I was thinking about this last night, too, about all the great things I could say about drawing and my, you know, what it's like to draw things like that, but it's not the same time as when you're doing it, you know. It's another. But I'll say that's what we're going to do, all those things on tape, so don't waste your film when I'm being angry now. Not angry, but...
So how long did this one take?
I don't know, 4 hours, something like that. I mean, I just did nine drawings in an hour or so.
What would be the selling price of?
I don't know, you have to talk to my dealer. Oh, this is a weird shot. I don't think how much it's worth and how long it took has anything to do with each other. Values based on a complete other set of principles.
Well, it's just there's something interesting to talk about anyway. What you work by as far as your values or your principles in art, and speed has nothing to do with it. It's what the inspiration at the moment, I suppose, is the valuable part about it.
Well, no, I thought. I mean, you're talking about two different kinds of value. I thought you were talking about money value. That has nothing to do with the value of the piece, really. Money's a complete separate thing, which really doesn't have anything to do with how long it took or how or what the value of the piece is, because money's based on an art market, which is something completely different. It has to do with other things besides how much the value of the thing. Most people can't tell which would migrate. I mean, I keep all the best paintings, because most people can't tell. Some people can tell. And my good friends can tell. And some good critics can tell. Tony can tell.
The idea of kids dropping out of school because of the new technology and that's available, try to find jobs or whatever. He didn't really know what he was going to do till this morning. Now he had a few ideas, and he said he doesn't really want to tell anyone till it's finished. You know, he just wants us to see what's going on as it happens.
Keith, why are you taking the drips off?
Because there's only a couple, and it really bothered them. I mean, every once in a while I do it. Every once in a while I paint the drips out, depending on what kind of painting it was. Because there's only about four or five drips on them, so they look out of place. No. They don't always like it. Especially with painting like this, because it really bothers, you know, I could tell it bothers them. Because it's like not poor crap. No. I've done it before a few times. I did it in Switzerland.
The sort of stupid action that you're doing here, same sort of stupid action when we get people that are going to draw it on their wall. Getting a bit fed up with telling you guys to behave yourselves. I don't want to say any more, Zoran.
Get in front of the wall quick before he chases you away.
All select Mr. McDonald.
You were asking me my opinion of Keith Haring, and I said that I thought he was sweet. I wasn't so sure at first, and then I thought, well, he's only a baby, he's 25.
Why only a baby?
25's no great age. What will he do next?
How long will it last, you mean?
How long will it last? It's a friend of Andy Warhol's. Considerable time.
And
the next video is about the making of the Collingwood mural. And look at this image, guys. A wooden door went missing soon after it was painted in 1984. And in 2013, the door was anonymously handed in at Arts Victoria which had been leading a project to restore this mural. And this man is the Italian Antonio Rava, a specialist contemporary art conservator.
Collingwood Tech was the forgotten school. You had to know how to survive. It was announced at school assembly that there was a famous artist coming to the school, Keith Haring.
That's right, yeah, I remember that.
He was a superstar when he came here.
I think he was more important to contemporary art than, say, Basquiat.
For Haring himself, that kind of breaking down barriers between high art and low art was very important with bringing in an urban community and particularly working class communities.
Keith came out with John, looked at the wall, said, yes, we'll do it. And he said, would you paint the backdrop? And I thought, well, how the hell are we going to do that? Where are we going to get the paint? And they said, well, we'll provide the scissor lift, we'll provide the paint and the rollers, you and some of the kids can do it. So we did.
All the kids, you know, that wanted to volunteer were asked to. My job was to drive the scissor lift.
So this is the only work that will be here forever or in Australia, is it?
Yeah, it's the only permanent thing that I did while I was in Australia, yeah.
That work was in a collection in the National Gallery of Victoria. It would have been conserved within an inch of its life. Situated right near the Tote Hotel, it had great culture around it, but it also kind of got urinated on a lot.
The Haring mural was deteriorating. Part of that, we thought, was probably because of the quality of paint that was used. It wasn't artist-grade paint, it was hardware store paint.
Everybody thought it was a ruin, it was lost, but we always thought we had to discover the real quality of the materials and the choking. I think people has the right to see the paint in his quality, and we have the duty to do it.
If the painting is still there and still readable and still the voice of the artist speaking to you, then it's been successful. It's what we always were talking about.
If Keith Haring still exists on that wall, then I think Collingwood Tech will still exist, you know?
All these people are doing different things, right? Some of them, they're like dancing, they're like rap dancing, or they're like acrobatic. Some of them are almost like they're fighting. But they're all, the way they're all together means that they can't, like if one of them comes out, the whole thing falls down.
Now in this short video, John Buckley, that curator in that video, and now with white hair, speaking about the making of the Keith Haring mural at Glamorgan School, and now Greenland drummer. So this work wasn't in that video. So now let's have a look.
Keith had been in Melbourne for about a week. He'd been painting the large glass wall of the National Gallery of Victoria. And had been meeting artists and generally kind of getting to know Melbourne a little bit. And I happened to be teaching here on what was then called the Glamorgan campus, which is now the Geelong Grammar School Toorak campus, and was still living here when Keith arrived from New York. And so he actually stayed here on the campus for about a week, and during the course of that time, probably towards the end of it, I think, I suggested to him that he might like to leave something behind here at the school for the children. Now, it's well known that Keith was very fond of children, and he was delighted to be able to do something. So we lined the kids up. I think they were all sitting on the grass watching him when he painted it, and it was done very, very quickly. This was then an outside wall of an old building, and so for a time this simple guardian angel that he painted for the children in what was then, that building was then the kindergarten, so it was very much for the toddlers. And he painted it very, very quickly, as he always did. It took him something like half an hour, maybe, tops. And the kids were delighted to watch it. Nobody had the faintest idea who he was or what he was doing here. And it's only really years later that there's been any interest in looking at what work Keith left behind whilst he was here in Melbourne.
And we've arrived at our food for thought moment. And today we are going to reflect on this Keith Haring's quote. And based on this quote, let's do a really cool activity. May art enter your soul, provoke your imagination, and may you be bold enough to go farther. Let's see the materials we will be using. A pencil and a rubber. Some thick black markers. A pair of scissors. Glue and tape. And A4 paper. A yellow card. A piece of paper to create the template. And some paper stripes for the pop-up. Ready? Let's get started! Alright guys, the first step is to draw the figure in movement, okay? The way you wish. And this is the template that will be traced on the yellow card. Trace your template with a pencil and press your fingertips down on the edge of that template so it doesn't slide around. Now get a thick marker to create a big, bold black line. Use the side of that and not the tip, alright? It's very important to use a large, bold line. When you've gotten what you want. Next, get some scissors and cut literally right next to that big black line. Don't cut inside the black line or outside the black line. Literally, right on the black line. Now use the tape to place the figure right in the middle of your A4 paper. Be creative to create some movement lines. I'm going to use this Keith Haring's Aboriginal painting to get inspired. Use a lot of wavy lines, diagonal lines, broken lines. There are so many different lines you can create with. Make sure your lines go in a direction and they are symbolizing something. Like, I'm drawing a guy with his hands up. He's having a good time. So don't be scared, so just have fun with it. Broken lines that show movement. Lines around, lines outline, lines with more lines. You are going to be making some curved lines as well, some wavy lines. But make sure that your lines don't touch the other lines. Now, for the final phase, I need that Aboriginal painting. So I decided to put more lines inside of the figure. The lines I have decided to add, more shapes, circles, are really popular with Keith Haring circles, with X's as well, lines around, okay? To reinforce the action that your figure is doing, it's important to use movement lines. So you keep it nice and neat. Okay, don't touch the other lines. So I really want you to have fun with adding more movement lines. We'll be right back. finally it's time to do the pop-up of this figure. Get some paper stripes, and to create the pop-up, fold the paper stripe in zigzag, put some glue on each piece, and place it back in his location. Enjoyed watching this video. Have a great day. Next week, guys, we have more. Bye.